Thank you, Dr. Crockett. We're really glad to have all of you here for this very special conversation with the President. March is Women's History Month, and so we wanted to start the month by inviting a distinguished woman leader who's been an entrepreneur to come and be part of a special conversation. I got to know Jessica within the last year and incredibly impressed with her background and experience. She's originally from New Jersey, completed her undergraduate degree at Brown. While she was there, she had this vision for starting a new company called Jessica's Wonders, which was a baked goods company. And in order to get it funded initially, she taught aerobics 6 times a week. So she's a living embodiment of doing all that it takes to get your venture off the ground. After graduating from Brown for undergraduate degree, where she studied anthropology, she also earned a master's degree in business administration, an MBA from Northwestern University. She subsequently started another amazing startup organization called BabbaCo, which would provide opportunities for parents to engage young kids in a monthly subscription service. So there would be different items in a box that would come each month and give you a chance to sort of engage. Celebrities were subscribers for the service. It was an amazing program. She's now the entrepreneur in residence at Charles River Ventures here in Boston. Brings a terrific experience of starting 2 successful programs, and in the process of that, getting distinguished. She's honored as Crain's 40 Under 40, as well as Babbel's Top 40 Mompreneurs. So moms who have started entrepreneurial ventures, which is exciting. She's married to her college sweetheart, Peter, and they have 3 kids. We're delighted to be able to welcome. Please join me in welcoming to Gordon College, Jessica Kim. Jessica, when we're growing up, each of us has what we might call an expected life story.
Yes.
It's sort of what our life is supposed to be like when we grow up. It's rarely articulated, but we pick it up from our parents, from our teachers, from our friends, of what our life is supposed to look like when we're an adult. What was that expected life story, and how has your life either aligned with it or diverged from it?
So I always think about the question that we always get asked. Do you guys remember getting asked the question? You probably get it now. Like, what do you want to be when you grow up? Like, everyone's probably asking you now, what are you going to do after college? What job are you going to have, right? So I remember always getting asked that question. And even when I was little, when I was 10 years old, I'd be like, I don't know. But what I do know is that I want to study people. I have just been so intrigued by people and how our culture and upbringing and situational experiences have kind of shaped our world perspective. And literally right now, all of us are in this room and we're hearing the same words, looking at the same movements, but the way we interpret what that means and how we internalize that to us in our own lives, like, is different for every single person. And I find that completely so fascinating. And luckily, I was the youngest of 3 kids, and my dad was a psychiatrist. So you can imagine the way I got punished was a lot of lectures. But luckily, he didn't kind of push me and tell me, you need to be a doctor, a lawyer, or engineer, or anything like that. He just said, you know, do what you love, but then once you choose that, do it really well. And so when I went to college, I went to Brown University, and I still loved studying people, so I majored in anthropology. And I was basically barefoot for most of my college years, and I thought that I would graduate and go to a far-off village and study tribes. Like, that's what I thought I was gonna do. But one thing led to another, and I was just following and having fun. In my sophomore year summer, I started baking out of my dorm room. And I walked into a pizzeria, and it was a local hotspot, and this guy was selling banana bread, and it was saran wrapped, and so I knew it wasn't made professionally, so I said, wait, who makes this? And he was like, this woman down the street, and I'm like, I can do so much better than that. My banana bread is amazing. He was like, bring it in. So I brought in my banana bread, and I wrapped it up, and I went back an hour later, and he sold out, and I was like, what? And he's like, bring more in. So I did it again. I was like, I want people to know that I made this. So I made a sign literally out of construction paper and markers, and I called it Jessica's Wonders, and my slogan was, so good, it'll make you wonder. And it was like a, like when you taste something really good. And it started selling out and selling out and selling out. And after the 10th loaf, I was like, hold on, don't you need to pay me for this? Like, I wasn't even charging him for it. That's how basic I was in business. I didn't come from a family of business. So long story short, I ended up selling to 13 different hotspots, baking out of my little efficiency oven. And then there was a business plan competition on campus, and it was the first one ever at Brown. And so I entered it, and 77 teams entered, and they picked two winners. And so Jessica's Wonders was one of the winners. And what I got from that was a $3,000 check, which I thought was a lot of money at that time. But more importantly, they hooked me up with a lot of mentors. So very early on, I saw such the value of having experienced mentors in your life. So I ended up, you know, running the business throughout college, teaching aerobics to make money to buy the ingredients. And then I raised $1 million my senior year. I looked like I was 13 years old. I had braces. I look back now, I'm like, why did people invest in me? But I positioned the whole company like the Ben & Jerry's of baked goods. And it was kind of like this whole brand, really great flavors, Kelly Jelly Banana kind of names. And then we grew it to several million revenue in less than 2 years. So it was an incredible, incredible, very raw experience of just entrepreneurship, what it meant. And I realized that I just like fell in love with it. Yeah.
Did you think of yourself as an entrepreneur when you started doing this, when you went to the pizza guy?
No, not at all. I didn't even know how to spell entrepreneur. I didn't know what it was. I think when I look back at it, it was, and it wasn't as hot of a topic as it is right now. Like, entrepreneurship is very hot right now. We see all these stories more and more. We see younger people doing it. And at that time, it was the first ever competition at Brown University. And it was seen more as like a risky thing, or there wasn't a lot of resources. To put that into perspective, once I was starting the business, I said, I need to write a business plan. Do you know what I did? Because there were no resources on campus. We didn't have a Carter. I went to a regular bank, waited in line. Everyone was getting money out of their check account. And I went to the teller and I said, can someone help me write a business plan? And the person looked at me, but they also took me under their wing. You always have to ask. And I met with a banker. They didn't really know as much about like a whole business plan, but they kind of showed me a balance sheet and things like that. And so I just had to hack together kind of the resources, but I didn't even think of it as entrepreneurship. I was just like, I just need to figure out how much money am I gonna make? How much am I gonna charge this guy? So what am I paying for the ingredients? How much am I gonna charge? Am I gonna pay myself? Like, and what is that margin and what is that profit? It was so raw. But I look back and I'm so grateful for that. And I try to always approach everything with that rawness, because I think sometimes when you kind of think about what's the proven method, you don't actually innovate. So
in addition to finding out about your start in entrepreneurship, we also want to learn a little bit about your life of faith. Mm-hmm. So has faith always been important to you?
Yeah, you know, I grew up in a Christian home. But my parents were immigrants from Korea, so it almost became a little bit more of like a cultural place to go. It was always a very small church with a very small youth group. And then we stopped going in middle school. But I remembered some of that. And so later in middle school and high school, I went through just, you know, I think it was, you know, we all have our stressful moments and low moments. And I just remember feeling so confused, and I started seeking out and going back to the youth group on my own, even though my parents weren't going. And so I would drive, and it was over an hour away. So I would drive to go to youth group, and I remember Pastor Eugene Cho, who is now an amazing leader, and he's a pastor in Seattle. He leads One Day's Wages, and that's when he was in seminary school, and he was my youth group leader of 10 people, and I just never heard the word spoken in the way that he brought the Bible to life, and it just struck my heart. And the way I always see it is, one of the fruits of the Spirit is peace, and it's something that you cannot purchase. And in this world where you can buy comfort and convenience and happiness, like, you can't buy this inner peace. And that's what I felt at that time, and I continue to feel, and it's stronger, is this peace in the midst of so much unknown and chaos and in your individual life and in the world. It's like, where it's that peace and it's that reassurance of the redemptive work that was done on the cross and that he is ultimately in control of all. And that is what I base my faith on, amongst other things.
Some people, after they have sort of a sincere engagement with Jesus, they continue on the life of faith all the way through. And other folks, it's sort of ups and downs along that spiritual journey, especially entrepreneurs can have ups and downs. So how was it for you? Was your faith sort of on a steady stream, a foundation through the whole process, or were there moments where God felt more distant or closer?
Yeah. I mean, there are, of course, moments where you feel a little bit distant or you have low moments, but I actually realized that I love entrepreneurship because it draws me closer to God. I think through going all in and trying to figure out in the midst of the unknowns and creating things, and I mean, you literally looking at a blank slate, and so you have to ask the questions of, what is this going to be? Why am I doing this? How are you going to do everything from what your office culture is to what your product is to how you're going to market? And so it makes me more active in asking those questions and knowing that I myself don't always have the answers and I need to ask the Lord. And so, of course, it's not always honky-dory, and it's, you know, there are stressful moments, and we can talk about all those stories. But I think even in the stressful moments, I feel more alive. I feel more close to the Lord. And so that's, for me, why I realize I think this is the right thing for me, because it's not drawing me further away. I feel like anything we do, any role we have, the question you ask yourself is this drawing me close to the Lord, or is this a roadblock to my relationship with the Lord? And that's when you know you're in the right place and you're doing the right thing.
So after you started Jessica Wonders, while you were in college, you continued with it, and then eventually you went to go work for Kraft Foods.
Yes.
So tell us about that journey and then how you wound up in business school.
So after Jessica's Wonders, I went to business school, actually, because I was like, what just happened? I felt like I was drinking out of a fire hose. And so I went to business school, and it was really great to kind of understand the frameworks and the theories and everything. And then I went to Kraft Foods, and it was pretty intentional because I wanted to learn what it was like to go from a small startup, literally in my dorm room, to a Fortune 500. So I wanted to stay in the food industry so the different industry didn't skew my view of what was the same or different. And so I went to Kraft Foods, and I was there for 3.5 years. And I actually loved it. Some people say entrepreneurs can't work for people. And I actually loved understanding the structure of how a big company operates. And I use that knowledge all the time. And how to, you know, create financial statements. And I was the brand manager of Miracle Whip and mayo, which is literally the only thing in the world that I hate eating. And then barbecue sauce. And I think it was a really great way to learn the structures of business. But what I missed after a couple of years was the raw passion that you felt, and you feel so close to the mission and the customers and just all aspects of it. And so I actually got pregnant with my daughter while I was still at Kraft, and they had this amazing maternity leave program where, you know, I had basically 6 months where I could work part-time. But I was so used to, like, working so much and, like, around the clock that I was like, the baby sleeps a lot. And so I ended up thinking, like, wow, the world of parenting is a whole new world. What you think about, what you buy, how you think about the world changes. And I just didn't see, I saw a lot of brands that were talking about, oh, get this product. I mean, they're trying to sell parents so many things. And I realized that you can buy your kids a lot of things, but the most important thing that you can give to them as a parent is your time, your attention, and your love. And so I thought, how do we do that? Because it is actually hard to do that as a busy parent. You're tired. And so just from my own parenting, I realized I need the stuff. Like, I would read all these articles about, this is a great craft you can do. This is a great science experience you could do. And I was like, where am I going to find the Q-tips and the screwdriver and the, you know, I was like, oh, that's why you never do it. So I thought, okay, what if we create these activity boxes and just, like, send them out and it has everything in it. So if you need to glue something, it didn't say, oh, get your glue. It was like, here's the glue. And so we made it really super easy so the parent can just really focus on the time that they're actually spending together.
And so that became BabbaCo?
BabbaCo, yeah.
But before you launched BabbaCo, you thought about doing something else or experimented with something else. Originally started like as an infant car seat cover?
Yes. So initially it was more of like, okay, we're going to be the Martha Stewart of baby. And so I started creating all these great innovative products. And the first one was an infant car seat cover. It goes over the car seat. It looks like a buggy. It's cute. But it's a sewn product. And I didn't know how to sew. And so what I did was I taught myself how to sew watching all these old ladies sewing on YouTube. And I would just watch them and watch them. And I remember taking home ec in sixth grade. And so I remember like threading the bobbin a little bit. But I just watched all these YouTube videos and I just taught myself how to sew. But it didn't look pretty. And when I had this little kind of, you know, triangular rounded corner design I had in my head, I didn't know how to do that. So I stapled it and I duct taped it. And I literally just hacked together this prototype. And it just, the whole point of a prototype is to just get across, to communicate what is in your head. What is this? What's the function of it? So I got to the point, and then I went to the local dry cleaners, because they have seamstresses there. And so I went to the local dry cleaners, and I said, talked to the seamstress, and I said, can you make this look prettier? Because I know you are an expert in this. And, you know, we had this whole conversation. She did it, and then she took me under her wing because, you know, and then she just taught me what it was to have, like, a pattern, and how do you kind of take a shirt apart and actually, you know, cut and sew all the different pieces. And so I think you can see this running theme of just kind of, like, going out, just, you don't have to Google and find the expert in anything. Just who knows how to do that next step? It's all about these little micro steps. It's very doable. And then when someone is willing to help you, you go 5 million times forward with them. So even with the bakers, I remember I went to a local bagel shop and I said, I'm going beyond my own college efficiency oven capacity. Can you help me? And he's like, well, I get here at 3 a.m. So if you want help, you got to get here at 3 a.m. And I was like, okay. And I was there by 2:45 with two coffees in hand, and I was like, I'm ready. And it just was that kind of attitude that people then say, you know what, she's really eager and she really wants to learn, I want to teach her. And so I felt like that's also something that I even continue to do, you know, in terms of someone trying to help you or mentor you.
And eventually, BabbaCo becomes widely popular.
Yeah.
You have Jessica Alba and Tori Spelling, different people who are, you hang out with them or?
No.
No. Okay. But they got your products.
Yes.
So how do you take an idea that originally you think it's going to be one product and eventually become something very different?
Yeah. So actually, so we were creating all these products and we were more of a, we were manufacturing them, selling at Target and Babies R Us and everything. And what I noticed with everything with social media and companies and our culture just being more direct with consumers, like we really have a voice as a consumer now, I realized I'm out of touch with that because I just sell it to the store, pallets of these products, and then I have no idea who's buying it and when they're buying it or why they're buying it. And so I got into a program called TechStars, and it's kind of a tech startup accelerator. And so they choose, it's like the American Idol of startups, right? So they choose 12, you go through this program, and then you have this big demo day at the end. So we were chosen to be one of those companies. And through that program, I met a ton of mentors, and we just discussed, like, how do we get more direct to consumer? And that's when one of the mentors was like, you know, you have a really great opportunity to do the subscription model where you have a great brand, people want this, it's an ongoing behavior. So, you know, so then that's when I came out with the activity box. And then that's when we raised our first round of venture capital funding at the end of that program. And then we grew from there.
So it sounds like it's been this sort of straight linear path of tremendous success. But perhaps along the way, there have been some bumps or some failures. What's been your biggest failure?
Actually, you know, it's interesting. It's a perspective on failure, right? But I think back, so it actually answers also the question of what happened to BabbaCo. So if you imagine all these years and hustle and everything building this product of these activity boxes, and the whole point of it was to kind of create a connection between mom and dad, right? I mean, mom, the parents, and the kids. And that's the number one reason why people joined and got the product. The number one reason why people canceled the product was because I don't have time. And so you're thinking this whole company is about creating these special moments between parent and child. That is like the whole purpose. Everything is around it. That's why we raised millions of dollars. That's why I'm hiring people. That's why we're creating this. It was soul crushing to me to then get the results back to say the number one reason why people are canceling and not buying your product anymore is because they don't have time. And so I look at that, and of course then we like tweaked it and then said, you know, we have to figure out like why don't they have time for this? And you know, but the one thing they had time for is to read a book, because that was existing behavior. And so that's actually what led to the acquisition. You know, because everyone read the books that we had in every box, and then Barefoot Books is a company that's a children's publisher, and then they said, oh, we want more activities, let's do this partnership together, so they acquired the company. So in a sense, you think, oh, wow, your company got acquired. What a success. You're so lucky. And as an entrepreneur who's very mission-oriented and very vision-oriented, I look at that, and I actually say, okay, we closed the loop, but I did not achieve like the ultimate mission of why I even started it. And I now know clearly why, and I look back and look at the assumptions we made or the mistakes we made and all of that, and I'm taking all of that to my next venture. So I don't see it as like a failure, but what I do see is it's these hard lessons where you should be, and you should embrace kind of the self-awareness and understanding of why it happened, and then how does that make you stronger? But so that's kind of what I see as like, if it were up to me, I would still be running BabbaCo. I didn't want to build it just to sell it.
Hmm. What's next?
Yeah. So after spending 2 years at Barefoot, I reconnected with my investor who led my Series A round at BabbaCo. And he was like, come on, you're a startup person. Don't you want to do it again? And at that time, I didn't have any ideas or inspiration or anything, but he basically gave me this amazing opportunity to be an entrepreneur in residence. So Charles River Venture is a venture capital firm, so they're investors, they invest in all these, you know, startups. And they basically gave me this past year to just have space and time to think about what's next. And so what I structured my time was, I basically did 1 month digging deeply into a problem or area that I was always intrigued by, but I just never had time to really explore it. So everything from like women and working, to senior care, to management, training and software, and everything like that. And so where I'm ending up now, it's still in the very early stages, so I'm about to start my next venture again. But it's around, you know, personal and professional development of living the most intentional and productive life that you can. And so actually, as a Christian, I'm incorporating a lot of kind of what I see as, you know, the values that we have as believing in our Savior and just kind of making it accessible and to kind of help change lives through that. So
wonderful. So we're going to invite you, if you have a question you want to ask to get into the conversation, you can text or email that to us and we'll bring it into the conversation with Jessica. I noticed that you're a musician as well.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah? So how does your background in music somehow influence the way in which you approach entrepreneurship?
That's a great question. I've never gotten asked that question. It's interesting because now I have 3 kids, right? So my kids are 10, 7, and 4. And I make them do music. I grew up doing it. And I think more than anything, more than being kind of a musician or a tiger mom or anything like that, it builds a sense of perseverance, of discipline, of practicing, of having that lead up to kind of like a performance. And so I don't expect my kids to be professional musicians, but I love the character building of what that activity does. And so I think when I look back, man, it can be very tedious practicing a lot. And I got to the point where I went to the Juilliard pre-college division, you know, so it was really intense. I would practice like 3 hours a day, and I had like, you know, that big mark on my neck and everything. And sometimes I was like, what's the point of this? Or I asked my mom at one point, I was like, why did you push me to do that? And then you didn't want me to be a musician, because at one point I loved it so much I wanted to. And I look back and I was like, it's because it built the character of discipline in me and a performance and of succeeding or failing in those performances. And so I think that absolutely added to that.
Questions are coming in. Is there an entrepreneurial fish that got away from you?
An entrepreneurial fish that got away from me?
Yeah. An idea that you were interested in launching or pursuing that you ended up not going down that path?
Gosh, in this last year, so many. It's interesting that I get really excited about different ideas and things, and I'm sure you read an article or you see a product, you're like, why didn't I come up with that? And so what I realized, though, we're so focused on the idea of things, you know, what's the next big idea, what's the next big product, and that's all you're thinking about. And when I realized entrepreneurship really is, it's not about the idea, it's about the process leading up to it, and it's about the people. Like, it's focusing on the people. Like, who are the people that are involved in your venture? Who are the people that you're serving? Who are your customers? Why are they using it? And you kind of, like, constantly dig into that. And so there are so many product ideas, someone was just telling me that they had this great app of making, you know, going out so much easier, and you just click of a button, and it covers everything that you need to do in one click, like Uber, your reservations, all that stuff. And I look at that, and I actually can see, okay, I can see people buying that and using that, and I can actually intellectually see a business plan of that succeeding. But for me, for myself, I'm like just not excited about that because I just didn't see the core kind of impact that it really had. So my view on just like ideas and entrepreneurship is that it really is from our greatest commandment, which is to love your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and it's to love others. And so the question I ask myself in the beginning, the end, and throughout the middle is this loving people? Like, does this put them in a better spot afterwards? And that is how I discern what I'm going to get involved with.
So lots of questions are coming in.
Sure.
As a woman, how do you manage pursuing entrepreneurship and being assertive in what's oftentimes viewed as a man's world?
Yeah.
And in particular, have there been difficult negotiations where you found yourself as a woman having to be in a more difficult space than you would have been if you were a man?
Yeah. Great question. I have tons of thoughts on this. but I think the best story to tell is, well, first of all, my dad as a psychiatrist brainwashed me very early on. Because I grew up in a town where there weren't that many minorities and Asians and things. And so very early on, he was like, it doesn't matter if you're a woman, if you're a man, if you're Asian, whatever, you are who you are, be yourself, and just own it. And so he's brainwashed me to be like, the more different you are, it's actually better. So it's shaped where if I go into a room and I feel a little bit different, I actually feel like, okay, how am I going to utilize this my advantage? So I first think it's the mindset of how you even see situations. But I definitely have a story here where after I raised my initial round of funding for BabbaCo, and it was the first time with these big venture capital investors, I raised my $1.2 million, and then it was like, you have to go. So we were running, hustling, working so hard. And a couple months into it, I was like, I'm so tired, and I'm usually not tired. And I was like, oh, I know this tiredness. I was pregnant. I got pregnant with my third child. And I was like, I was upset. I was worried. I was full of anxiety. I was like, how am I going to do this? And this is the year that I had to prove myself. This is my chance. And I'm pregnant? Ugh. And so that insecurity actually showed when I was initially talking about it. And I threw out everything my dad told me about owning this situation and being different. I was like, this is going to be hard. So I had to raise my next round of funding, my Series A, and here we were going for $5 million. And I would go into these meetings or coffee meetings, and you can tell that I was nervous. I was like, don't worry. I've done this before. I got this. Like, I'm going to work harder. And surprisingly, some people just are not into it, but I think most importantly, they were not reacting well to my insecurity. And so I got really frustrated, and I'm at the point where I'm like, if I don't raise this money because of everything and how we built the business, we have to close our doors. So it was very stressful. So I said, you know what? Forget it. So I walked into a New York meeting, and I said, at that point, I was like, I'm just going to own this. And so I walked into a New York meeting, and I was presenting the business. And I was about, like, 5 months pregnant, so you can kind of tell, but you never ask. and they said, I was just pitching the business. And then the investors were like, oh, great. So, you know, what about the sibling boxes and everything like that? And I was like, oh, yeah, great. And by the way, I'm pregnant. And they're like, oh, wonderful. You know, is this your first child? And I was like, oh, no, 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 no. This is baby number six. Like, I am really into this baby industry thing. Yeah. Anyways, so the customer acquisition cost is going to be $45, and it's going to go. And I just went right into pitching again. And the whole time, these guys in New York were staring at me with this fake smile because they didn't want to be inappropriate. And they were like, oh my gosh, this girl is crazy. Like, it is hard enough to raise money and to run a business in this high-tech space. And here she is pregnant with her sixth baby? Like, how do we end this meeting? Like, the smile is like that the whole time. Oh, yeah. And I don't know how long or how many minutes it was, but I felt like it was a long time for them. And then I just was like, oh, and by the way, I'm not pregnant with baby number six. It's just number three. You feel better, right? And they're like, oh my gosh. And they're like, yes, we do feel better. Oh my, that was a good one. And we were cracking up. And then we just went on in the pitch. Those investors ended up kicking off that $5 million round. And I raised my round of funding. And that was a huge personal lesson to me. That, like, you know, who you are, everything, like, how you carry yourself, what your personality is, because often people say, you're so bubbly. Are you taken seriously? Like, how do you do business? And I used to have an insecurity on that. And I was like, you know what? Who you are, everything about you, God created that for a reason. And instead of trying to change that to be something else, you have to embrace that and own it. And it's that confidence, and more importantly, your mindset, that's going to allow you to kind of negotiate or go through any obstacles. So,
are you actively trying to cultivate entrepreneurial virtues in your kids?
That's funny. Great. These are great questions. I don't know if it's like as an active, intentional thing, because I really do believe that they have to find their own path. But it is really interesting. So people ask me, like, do you struggle with being a mom and being so busy as an entrepreneur? And does
That's
that make you a bad
here.
Mom?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. And I think it's related because, and my daughter is 10 now, and I have a 7-year-old and a 4-year-old, they're boys. And Kayla, I started the business when she was 4 months old. That's when I started BabbaCo. So she has literally grown up seeing me build this business. And what I've seen is, like, we were going to a yogurt place, right? And it closed down. And it was one of the worst winters here in Boston. I think it was a couple years ago. And she goes, Mom, Yogurtland closed down in Newton. I'm so sad. And I'm like, oh, I know. And she was 8 at that time. I was like, I know. Talking to her like an 8-year-old. Don't worry. We can go to Sweet Tart or whatever. And she goes, you know what? It's probably because we had the worst winter, and no one went in there, and they couldn't make enough money, and so they went out of business. And so she's like, so we need to support even in winter. And she literally said that, and I was like, what? Who are you? And it hit me that she's absorbing all of this so organically, and that it's shaping her, whether she becomes an entrepreneur or not, just like real world stuff. And so I feel like, you know, being an entrepreneur makes me a better mom, and I feel like the kids are benefiting from seeing all of that. So again, I just feel like it's so aligned.
Are you willing to share your banana bread recipe?
Okay, who asked that?
Yeah.
I do not share the recipe. I shared it once with my sister, but that's it.
Is it still possible to get Jessica's Wonders?
It's not. So it's interesting. So after selling that business, a couple years after, they kept it going. And what I realized early on is when you base a company so much around your personality and the person, when you get the Jessica out of the Jessica's Wonders, people are like, where's the Jessica? And it was too early. And so after I realized what the power of a personal brand and what it has on a brand, but since we sold it and I wasn't part of it, they just kind of, you know, stopped selling it.
Some people in Silicon Valley promote starting a business in lieu of going to college. Do you agree with that?
My honest answer is no, I don't. I really believe in the college education, more so about the experience. It's you and your peers. It's, you know how I was talking about music and how it builds discipline? Like, your time here is building so much character, and you're learning habits, and you're, like, stretching how you think about things. And sure, you can do that in your own kind of business, but it's different because you don't have this whole room full of people. You don't have this whole full shared experience. And it's such a safe place. I'm a huge promoter of starting a business during college. That you can do, and I'm a huge fan of that. Because this is an amazing, unique opportunity and time in your life where you have mentors wanting to help you. You have guests come, like, people just want to help you, and it's a safe place where, like, the main point here, your main goal here is to, like, learn, take your tests, exams, and graduate. And so, you know, anything in between, like, you have room to fail. You have room to try things and explore and prototype things. And if it doesn't work, it actually makes you better because it shows your character of trying something. And so, but I totally believe in the college education. I think you're missing out on a huge life experience if you don't have it.
And how did your liberal arts education give you an edge, you think, as an entrepreneur, or your area of interest in anthropology? How does it make you a better entrepreneur than if you'd gone in and been a straight up business or management kind of?
It's exposure of different thinking. It's exposure of different worlds. Like, it's, once you get into the real world, everything you read and everything becomes very practical. You're gonna get a job and you're gonna read and train on that specific skill. It's very few people explore history on their own or explore anthropology or media arts and things like that. And more importantly than learning the facts, because believe me, I don't remember a lot of the facts, it actually shapes your thinking and perspective, and it just makes you realize, oh, that world is a completely different world. And, you know, so how do I get inspired by that to apply it to this? So everyone would tell me, like, you're not an economics major, but you're an entrepreneur and you're totally in business. I feel like being an anthropology major was the best thing that I draw upon more than any finance class I've ever taken. Because if you think about, at least for me, like, consumer businesses, I don't care what product you have, if you don't understand the actual psychology or the environment or context or desire or behavior, existing behavior of your consumer, your product is not gonna work. And so that consumer insight is totally rooted in anthropology. So, huge proponent of that.
Do you have a favorite or life Bible verse or passage that's really meaningful to you?
So many. I think, like, Psalm 115, not to us, Lord, not to us, but to you be all the glory. I think that, especially in entrepreneurship, there's a lot where people kind of put you on this pedestal. And even when you're introducing me, I'm like, what? I feel like I'm still trying to figure it out. I feel like I'm still striving to be closer to God and to be a better person and everything. And so whenever I think it's not to us and it's not about us, it does a couple of things. It's like, it reminds me what the ultimate purpose is for everything, but it also takes the pressure off of me because it's not about me. And I feel like we're, it's everything we do, all the roles we have, everything you end up doing in life is just an overflow of your relationship with the Lord.
Do you have any living heroes? People who have been very inspirational to you?
A lot of, you know, I'm the type of person where I'm not a huge celebrity, or I don't, like, worship celebrities or anything. So I always think about the key people in my life. And so, of course, like, my dad and my mom. And then there are a couple of key business mentors throughout my career that have just been so humble and giving in their time. So,
wow.
Yeah.
Well, it's a great blessing to have you here. Jessica,
yeah,
we have a small gift that we wanted to present to you and to say our great thanks. Please join me in thanking Jessica Kim for being here.
Thank you, guys. Aw, yeah, thank you.
Before we depart, let me close this with a word of prayer. Gracious God, we give you thanks, for every good gift comes from you, and we know that. We pray that all that we are about, our daily work, our studies, our discovery of things that we're passionate about, we pray that all that we are about would honor and glorify you. In the season of Lent, we're reminded of the great gift of Jesus Christ and the difference that he has made for all eternity for us. We want to commit our lives to honoring him and to being people who do your work. So today, we ask that you would speak to us in a real and profound way, that we might pursue the calling that you would have on our lives to love you wholly and to love our neighbor. May we be your ambassadors this day, as we pray in Christ's name. Amen. You're dismissed.